What have I done? What have I become? I can't describe this.
Hello and welcome to the Mid-Mic Crisis. I am Bunchu alongside my esteemed colleague and co-host Chamber. Chamber, how you doing, buddy?
I'm doing all right, man.
You look less sweaty this week.
I am. I got home about an hour ago, so my core temp has dropped. It's still a little sweaty, but only like 15% moisture, I would say.
You look magnitudes less moist. So I'm ready here.
Quite moist on the last episode.
How's everything going? What's new in the life of Chamber?
Just try to enjoy the summer. We got some holidays coming up in a couple weeks. Got the beach house going. Going down to Dead Man's Cove. Damn right. Not the exact cove, but pretty close to the same cove.
One of the coves.
Yeah, I upgraded the house.
No one's dead yet.
Not yet, exactly.
For those who have not been listening to this show long, Dead Man's Cove comes from our 2018-2019 days where we used to do a segment called Real Life Wrecked, and Chamber told a story about how on one of his family holidays, a dead body washed up on the shore of his Airbnb, and so we call it Dead Man's Cove, and there's a shirt in the merch store somewhere.
there is a shirt in the merch store. R.I.P.
Yeah, lots and lots to talk about today. I've got chock full of new AI news, some cool demos to show you that I think will just continue to blow your mind. What will you be talking about today? Anything going on in the crypto world?
We've seen some positive momentum post Saturday. It's the correlation for what took place over the weekend.
Yes.
Had a positive effect on crypto, it looked to be. Yep. I see a lot of tweets saying we were, a half an inch away from 16K Bitcoin, which
<That's> so fucked up.
Here we are. It's been good, but big weekend down in the States. I feel by Monday though, it was like kind of, it was over.
Which is just like so insane to think about, like what the news cycle is like these days. You know what I mean?
Where... I was talking to my dad about it. I was just like, yeah, because I think we were talking on Sunday, and I'm like, honestly, by tomorrow, like it won't even be a big news story anymore.
Payne says he needs to learn how to save time and make money, which is the title of this episode. I'm not sure the content I brought today ended up fitting this, but we're going to go for it. I got things to show you. So anyway, with that, we've always running out of time lately. So let's get right into it. Let's go to the world of AI.
Feeling dumb, want some fun, time for some artificial
The first piece of news comes from none other than Sam Altman and OpenAI. And we're talking here about Project Strawberry and OpenAI's setting their sights on human level AI. So, Chamber, have you heard of Project Strawberry before?
I have not. No, this is new to me.
Okay, so what they're calling Project Strawberry focuses on enhancing AI models' ability to understand and process complex information, which is obviously a critical step in achieving the goal of AGI, artificial general intelligence. And I mean, if this has been, and I've said this before on the show, like we've talked to Sam Altman before, and his 100% goal of AI, or sorry, OpenAI, is to create and achieve artificial general intelligence. And the way he describes this is to that it will be able to create novel science. When I say those words to you, what does that mean?
Basically, novel in the sense new science, basically inventing stuff that humans have not yet.
Sure. Think
or
of
coming
like...
up or coming up with ideas or coming up with, you know, theories that, again, humans have not yet come across.
Sure, absolutely. So think of like, you know, curing cancer and things of that nature that we have not been able to appropriately crack for all these years. AGI will help us get there, according to Sam Altman. So obviously, human level AI reasonings, such as these, you know, cognitive understandings and the ability to kind of like take action, is what we're talking about here. And that can obviously transform a bunch of different industries by offering, you know, personalized empathetic interactions and just these overall skills that these models are going to have. If you were paying attention the other day, they also released this five levels or five stages of artificial intelligence that they briefed their own employees on a company meeting. And these five levels of AI, according to OpenAI, are level one, which is chatbots, AKA AI with conversational language. Level two is reasoners and human level problem solving. Level three is agents and systems that can take action. Level four, innovators. And so that's AI that can aid in invention, which is kind of what I was just mentioning. And level five, organizations. So AI that can do the work of an entire organization. Based on that, where do you feel like we currently are in this five levels of AI? I'll tell you where I think we are.
Can you describe three again for me? Because I don't think we're at four.
Three is agents, which is systems that can take actions. And then four is innovators.
I feel like we're at three. What do you think?
Yeah, I would say we're probably somewhere transitioning from...
into four?
I would actually say probably into two or from two to three.
Okay.
So these agents exist, right? But they are not totally great yet. So they're capable. Right. They have capabilities to do things, but somewhat unreliably, and they have to be kind of very specific in the tasks that they can do, or else they're going to kind of get lost in this endless loop. So you've kind of got to chain specific agents together. And while they may be able to kind of be tuned to do a certain task, the actual, you know, ordering of, you know, your groceries on Instacart and things like that can still be wonky. So when you think of like where true level three is going to be, it's going to be that, you know, Chamber, you've got your AI waifu, right? And you tell her to plan the perfect romantic date night to throw your wife off the scent. And all of a sudden you've got, you know, dinner at, you've got, you know, dinner plans booked, you've got a trolley ride booked all for you, and it's doing your taxes reliably and things like that. So that's kind of where I see like true agents, you know, but the bottom line is this stuff is going to be able to kind of create, which we're already seeing, reason, which we're already seeing, understand, and, you know, like that's the world we're headed to. So if you're not prepping for this stuff now, it's you're going to fall behind because it's happening really, really, really quickly. So OpenAI, no joke that this is where they're going for. They've been talking about this for years, and it's starting to take, you know, starting to come to fruition. And there's kind of this like AI arms race that's going on right now. Claude's kind of a little bit out in front in terms of models and all this stuff. And it's going to be weird to see kind of who comes out victorious. And overall, what this means is, you know, the price of intelligence and the price to be able to do stuff like this is going to zero. Like, what do you think happens in a world Chamber, where the cost and supply of intelligence is near infinite.
Four out of shape.
Four
dads
out of shape.
Welcome back to another episode of the Bad Dad Vice Podcast.
Hanging out once a week. Consuming beers.
Hello.
What will they say next?
Confucius said, you can go to bed with itchy butt, wake up with stinky fingers.
You ever use a bidet?
Bidet to you, sir.
Hand him a telescope so he can see Uranus from farther away.
Can we give some dad advice here? If the buttons on your shirt button the opposite way, That's the lady's shirt.
It's going to be difficult to say, like, I'm worried about groups kind of containing this type of power, having it available. Like right now, it's available to everybody, more or less. Is my mic better, by the way, now? Does it sound better?
Yes.
Okay. Payne, thank you very much for pointing that out. Bunch should be better. My only worry is having this at such a low cost. The only thing that's preventing us from doing whatever we want is higher powers kind of, gatekeeping that technology. If that does not happen, I mean, possibilities are endless.
Well, it's a good point, right? It's a good point. And so it's worth noting that if you're not like super deep into this stuff and you're just kind of following along to headlines and things like that, familiarize yourself also with kind of the open source stuff that's going on out there, right? So there's plenty. I mean, Facebook, who's got probably one of the best data sets to be training and building these models in the entire world, is open sourcing every single one of their llama models, right? And so what that means to you, Chamber, is that that kind of consolidation of power is kind of broadening. You could download that model and run it on a server of your own, a remote server, or at some point models might get small enough in which you can run them locally on your computer. Some of them you can today, but like, what does that mean? Well, it means, the open source stuff is kind of always kind of one generation behind the current stuff, but the fact that you can have GPT 3.5 level model downloaded on your computer in case the world gatekeeping happens, like, that's pretty powerful. So
that is,
it's worth exploring kind of and keeping up to date with what these latest models on the open source front are. And I always kind of just tell people, download them, right? Go to something like Hugging Face and download them, because you never know when overnight you won't be able to have this stuff anymore.
Totally. Which,
who knows if that is coming, but it might. Who knows?
I have been thinking of some, you were working on automations the other day, and I never know what to do. And I was thinking of, I thought of one that would be good for me. And I listen to a lot of podcasts. I would like a automation that would basically, I don't know if it's daily or weekly, but scan Spotify, Apple Podcast for specific topics that I like. Like, for example, I'm big into like Sasquatch and Bigfoot stuff. If there's a new podcast, because a lot of times you'll get, if you ever search for any podcast and you search for a specific topic, you get the most popular podcasts first, which may not be the,
we're always at the top.
Always at the top. So sometimes you might find a little, a diamond in the rough, if you will. So if I had an automation that compiled, say on Spotify, I think it would be even better, because then they could just create like a Spotify list with all of those things and just get an updated, whether it's Bigfoot stuff. I'm always interested in like what Mike Flanagan, who's like a movie director, he does a lot of podcasts and like weird ones where you don't know where he's going to show up. So I periodically, I'll just search Spotify or Apple Podcasts, but like if I had something automating that for me, putting them in a place.
You could totally make that. It's probably pretty easy. You could watch an RSS feed, right, for specific keywords, and you can have that deliver them right to a Slack message or a Discord message or something to you.
Or you could compile many things, right? Could be not just podcasts, but what if it's YouTube videos, podcasts, articles, and you have like a central hub that you get, you know, it all kind of collates together. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like the chamber hub.
I love it. I love it. I'm a big fan. But yeah, I think, yeah, something like that where it's maybe pulling data from a bunch of different media sources and then compiling them together.
Yeah, I love that. Zegzet calling you the Squatch Hunter.
That is
very accurate.
Big fan.
You're doing your best to blend in with them in their natural habitat.
Well, I was accused of maybe being part Sasquatch at one point.
Which part?
The top part.
Got it. I see. Awesome. Well, I know, you know, I keep talking about the practical uses of AI and what it can do to make your life better. And everybody just keeps asking me, Bunchu, yeah, this is all great, but how does this get me laid? And, you know, our good friends at Tinder have you covered here with their newest AI empowered feature. Chamber, you historically on this podcast have talked that you you know, have been out of the dating game for a very long time, as have I. Were you ever on these apps?
It's funny you say this. I was talking with one of my longtime friends the other day. We've been with our partners for considerable amounts of time, and we were having this discussion. We both missed an entire generation of dating.
Yeah,
a whole generation of dating has passed, and now it's a new generation of dating. I've done zero online dating. I remember when, you know, some of my friends started like Plenty of Fish. I don't know if that's still a thing. I thought that was a very funny name for a website. But yes, I remember my friends getting involved with this, but unfortunately never had the fortune or misfortune to try them out.
All right. Well,
I think fortune. You know, I think fortune. I think I would have a great time on a dating app if I was single.
Yeah, just put that fuzzy Bigfoot looking picture up, you know, that one that from like
I heard there's a lot of dudes just like holding like fish, like a lot of like rural like Tinder side, like guys.
Oh, there's certainly
like,
a,
trucks and fish. I'm like, I
yeah,
feel
there's
like
certainly
I would...
like a formula that you do. Like your profile has to show, you know, a close up face pic, a full body pic, something, you know, of you doing an activity or hobby that is physical, and then a dick pic at the end. That's close it all out. That's Zed Gazette, our friend ZG, says just divorced and fresh on the game after 10 years. And so this article is
what I want to know. I want a podcast of Zed Gazette explaining to me what it's like being in the dating world after 10 years, because it is very intriguing to me.
You know how you just asked for that really specific content feed automation? I basically get that every day in my chat with ZG. He updates me all the time on how it's going. So I kind of have that just shotgunned into my veins whenever I need it. So I can tell you, you would want to hear it. That's it. So, all right. So Tinder's got you covered here. So the popular dating app has introduced a new AI feature called Photo Selector. So speaking of which photos you have, right? This tool is designed to sift through a user's camera roll to identify the most attractive photos.
Really?
Thereby optimizing their profile to increase the likelihood of a right swipe. This feature has apparently been in testing since August of the previous year, so that's 2023, and aims to streamline the often laborious process of choosing profile pictures. What do you think of this?
I'm interested to see, do they go into depth on what factors they, like, what makes the AI think one picture is more attractive than the other?
Yeah, so this says the photo selector uses advanced AI algorithms to analyze photos and select those likely to perform best on the platform. So my guess is they've probably taken everybody's photos of the most, let's see, if I were trying to build this, you'd take all the most swipe right profiles. You'd find common themes amongst their pictures that are probably separate from just their, you know, overall looks, right? And features. And then you tag and categorize them. And so, it's probably got
Do you think it's more like what's in the background? Like if it's a nice like sunset or
it does say
outdoors.
It says most attractive. Your most attractive photo.
I wonder if there's like I wonder if there's like a ratio, like a face ratio that they can kind of hone in on.
There are scientific facts of what makes people attractive, right? Like facial symmetry and stuff like that.
Hogs.
So maybe. Yeah, totally. Like, you know, gonna scan through. Well, that's part of this, right? So this has got access to your camera roll, and it's seen as an enhancement to existing smart photos function, which already tried to automate the selection process based on swipe data. But here, users must take a selfie and provide access to their camera roll, allowing the AI to identify and present the best photos for the user's final selection. This feature is going to be rolled out by the end of the month, and it promises a digital companion experience. So I'm guessing then, based on the fact that you have to have a selfie, that's how it's identifying all the photos of you in your camera roll, right?
Right.
So
I think it's just kind of taking the pictures of me holding up like the date and like Coinbase, you know what I mean?
Yeah, your driver's license photo. Right, exactly. But I mean, this is interesting. To me, it somewhat raises questions about privacy and personal data and how that's being handled and analyzed. You know, what do you think on that?
I mean, I don't even worry about privacy and data anymore. I just assume it's all out there at this point and there's nothing I can do about it. So I don't care. If it's going to make my life easier, sure, let's do it. If it's gonna make me get a
it's gonna get you laid on Tinder.
If it's gonna give me an 8.5 as opposed to 7.5 all day
long. That's high ROI features.
Absolutely.
Right there.
Absolutely. You know?
very interesting. So they say a global launch is planned for sometime this summer, and it's again gonna act like a digital companion. And this is from the source Lawrence Bonk, which you just can't make that up, huh?
I feel like that is made up. That's a very Lawrence Bonk.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know what background Bonk is.
I don't either, my man. So I don't either. All righty. Last up from the news articles that I've got from the world of AI today, we are going from, you know, get you the date to Mr. Steal Your Girl, except this is Mr. Steal Your Content. Yeah, Mr. Steal Your Content. It's out there. Apparently, YouTubers across the globe are now finding out that AI models have been trained on YouTube videos without consent. So a recent report reveals that technology companies like Apple, Salesforce, and Anthropic have trained their AI models using a vast number of YouTube videos without containing consent. From the content creators. And this obviously is probably a violation of YouTube's terms of service and raises a ton of ethical concerns.
Do you think it's a violation of terms of service? Because I have to imagine they're just watching the video.
Yeah, right.
So it counts as views.
It does count as views. But
I don't think are they
downloading?
Yeah, I don't know. It's a download. I don't think they are. Like, would they be downloading it?
Probably. You'd probably have to, because you probably have to have the transcripts.
Well,
it depends. It depends on how they're doing it and what kind of model, right? If you're doing a multimodal, it's probably using vision to watch the video. If you're doing, you know, transcription, it's something. But a lot of this stuff is coming. Here you go. There's a little more detail here. Have you ever heard of The Pile?
Like from South Park? Everybody get in the pile?
I mean, it's kind of similar. So the pile, it's commonly referred to as the pile. It's a data set that was created by the nonprofit Eleuther AI, and it's played a central role in this process of training models. People have been training all kinds of stuff on this data set, which includes, like, you know, a couple months ago we saw authors suing for something similar. Those books were contained in the pile data set, right? Mm-hmm. So this says the pile includes YouTube captions scraped from over 173,000 videos, and that's been used extensively by both small and large companies for training. This was initially a data set intended to provide useful resource for those lacking immense resources of big tech. So, like, you know, if you have a startup that's trying to train a model and you can't go scrape the entire internet, this is kind of a watered down version of that. But obviously now we're finding out that major companies are using this as well. And a YouTube creator, well-known creator named Marquise Brownlee, highlighted the complexity of assigning blame, noting that while Apple sourced the data indirectly, the ethical responsibilities are murky. What do you think of this as a practice?
It's a good question. I'm not a big ethics guy, I'm going to be honest. I don't usually let ethics get in my way. Because the goalposts move all the time when it comes to ethics. You know, what was ethical 100 years ago is maybe not the same thing that's ethical today. So I'm okay with it as long as the end goal is betterment. You know what I'm saying? If these companies are using that information to make things better, or, you know what I'm saying? I think that the ends justify the means. I feel like that's where I come up with on this. If the ends are terrible, then obviously no. But if the ends are good, means are justified.
Fair enough. I think it's, you know, there's a quote in here from creator David Pacman. Nobody came to me and said, we would like to use this. This is my livelihood.
I know David Pacman. I mean, from YouTube. Yeah.
He's That's who this is. Yeah.
Yeah. He's a liberal politic guy. He's kind of a dweeb.
Dweeb or not, it's interesting in terms of, like, okay, this is the way somebody makes their living. The content is, and now the whole idea is, okay, well, this could be potentially replicated in both style, and now that all that content's used to train something. And, you know, what happens when all that stuff is out there? It's just, it's really interesting. And it's going to kind of be like, in my opinion, they're all going to keep doing it until there's some sort of regulations that say you can't anymore, right?
Like, were you looking at those glasses, by the way?
No, dude, I don't buy.
Those are good. I had a pair similar to that, so I was going to say.
That's like the one thing I don't buy. Is,
you don't buy sunglasses?
No, dude, no. I lose them. I sit on them. I break them. Absolutely not. When I worked at Sam Adams long ago, I covered the beaches of Delaware, which is a fantastic spot if you've never been. But they, we did like an activation down there where we made a bunch of these Ray-Ban knockoffs that said Sam Adams on the side. And I had, when I moved, I still had like 500 pairs of them, and I still do. And so I'm working my way through them. I probably have 200 pairs of them in my garage. So they're just throwaways. And anytime I wear sunglasses, I don't have to worry about treating them nicely.
See, I find sunglasses for me bring my attractiveness up. Like, we were talking a point, like 7.5 to an 8.5. I would say sunglasses for me increase my attractiveness. I would say a full point and a half to 2 points.
I would say that's probably true. You do look pretty sharp in sunglasses.
I love sunglasses.
So
I would recommend the ones that were coming up on your.
You like those ones?
I like those ones. Right. Yeah, those, I think they look good on you.
Maybe a show sponsor someday. Who knows? That is going to do it for our AI news. I have a bunch of other stuff to show you, though, in terms of off the cuff fun shit. Are you ready to get into that?
I am so ready.
Okay, but before we do, it's halfway through the show. Mm-hmm. We have to remind you now to like, subscribe, share, all of those things. And here's my little plug for things that I've going on. So I launched last week. I talked about it. We've got this, the awesome free Firebrain AI community. I am teaching everybody about all the AI stuff that I am learning about. So if this is of interest to you as a topic, come on, hang out with us. I've been doing these kind of weekly calls where open to everybody, come in and chat. We had a really awesome turnout this week, and I showed people a bunch of cool stuff on how to repurpose all of their content and things like that using AI and these really awesome mega prompt assistants that I created. So come check it out. This will be in the description. And Chamber, I don't know, do you want to start with the topic related to this community, the Firebrain AI stuff?
No, go ahead. I just wanted to add one more plug too. I thought a fun mm-hmm. thing for the people watching, on YouTube or listening, if there are specific, subjects you would like us to discuss on the show, drop them in the comments and we can always add those in any future, broadcast. So,
for sure. All right.
What do we got? Ready? What do we got? Yeah.
Well, this is the community. So just if you want to come hang out, this is where I'm living and sharing all the stuff that we're talking about in the AI world. You could also find this link in my Twitter bio as well. So come and check it out. We're doing some cool stuff in there, but maybe even cooler, Chamber. I don't know. As part of this project, I wanted to kind of build some cool stuff. You've been hearing me talk about automations and mm-hmm. all of this in the last couple weeks. I wanted to show you one of the outputs that I was able to fully automate. I've been thinking about this for quite some time. As soon as I learned about these tools, I knew I wanted to do this, and they weren't good enough yet when I wanted to do this the first time. And now all the tools are good enough to actually complete this. So I launched a new daily podcast out anywhere you can find podcasts. It's on YouTube. It's on Apple. It's on Spotify, as you can see here. It is called The Daily Ember. Firebrain AI is the topic, or is the kind of producer there. But this is a daily, you know, 15, 20 minute headline news of the day style, keep up with everything going on in AI podcast. But the coolest part, Chamber, it's all automated end to end. So literally everything about it is automated and done by AI. So we're talking the topics that are selected. So we're talking the topics that are selected down to the research, down to the script writing, down to the voice, which is my own voice, but duplicated. So I am delivering the podcast, but I'm
you sent this to me over the weekend or maybe on Monday. I was blown away on how high the quality of the voice was.
We're going to hear it in a second because I want to play it because I think it's pretty, I think it came out pretty, pretty damn good. So we'll listen to the first minute or so you get to hear what it sounds like. But the crazy thing about this, you know, putting out, look, you know how it is to put out a podcast. We have to do a lot of different tasks. We have to have producer Payne helping us out. You know, how long would you say it would take you on average if you did a show like this daily? How long would it take you to do,
including recording it?
Yeah.
So say I was doing like a 20 minute show, we'll say
20 minute news topic show.
It would, I would say hour of prep, 20 minutes of the show,
20 minutes of the show if you just do it live with no cuts and no
correct. Yeah, exactly.
You might, if you're reading a script for like articles and
if
news,
I'm editing, it's another add another 30 minutes on top of that if I'm editing, and then putting it out to all the different platforms is call it another 30. Like we're talking, you know,
I estimated
that 2 to 3 hours minimum.
Yeah, I actually estimated probably more like 4 if I had to do this daily, right? Like just the entire thing, select my topics, read all of those articles, create
reading
the content from them, right create the content from them that about each individual article, put them into a script, then go record it, edit it, publish
it. It's probably 4 or 5 hours maybe.
This took me to put this out today 20 minutes. And because in part of the process, I have to, so I get presented to me a list of all these articles of the day. Yeah. I'll show you more in a second of how it works, because I think you're going to like it. But I get presented with the articles of the last 24 hours and I select which ones I like. Then it goes off and does everything else. And then the only thing I have to do is just clip like the intro, and this can be automated. I just haven't done it yet. I just have to clip like the intro and the main body together, and then it sends it off to do everything else. But literally took me 25 minutes to do this. So I'll play what it sounds like just from the beginning, and then we can really quickly look through the process, and then I'll explain this. If you want to learn more, again, jump in that community I was talking about before, also linked here, and I'll show you exactly how we did this. But here it is. I think you're going to be able to hear this. Let me know if you cannot. Ready?
Today on Firebrain AI's Daily Ember, we'll cover all the latest in the world of AI, including AI's role in diagnosing Parkinson's, millennials leading AI learning trends, Anthropic's new AI chatbot for Android, and OpenAI's ambitious new AGI project. But before we get started, if you want to learn more about how to practically integrate AI into your business and daily life, join our free school community in the description below. Let's get to today's headlines.
It's AI, banger, banger intro. Also AI created.
That's a Bunchu AI created song for sure.
Yeah, that's a Bunchu AI created song.
First up, we head to OpenAI.
Then transitions right into the news.
Working on something huge called Stronger.
I got a nice little lo-fi beat going.
This project aims to make AI think similarly to humans. Imagine a computer that can understand and solve problems just
like. Isn't this crazy?
It's set to completely change things like how we shop.
If I heard this, if you just, hey, I made this today.
Mm-hmm.
I may not know. I was saying in the pre-show that it would take me a minute. You sent it to me and I told you it would take me a minute to figure out it was AI. Had you just sent it to me, especially this one.
Yeah, this one came out a little better than yesterday's.
Like really, really good. I don't know. Like I would say, oh, like he edited it. Like, you know what I mean? Where there's, you know what I'm saying? Like I find when you clean up audio, you can, there's almost like a polishedness to it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I would just have assumed that you took your time editing the show and that's why it sounds so clean. Because with AI, there's not those like pregnant pauses and stuff like that that we have as, you know, regular humans. So I would have just said you probably just, you know, cleaned it up.
But it even has like my inflection cadence almost exactly.
Like
it's crazy how good it was.
It's unbelievable how exact that is. Now, you had asked me late last week, do we get individual audio?
Yes.
And I said, yes. And then when you said that, I'm like, what could I do with my voice? Because I want to mess with people. See, my mind's like, oh, let's make something productive for the community. Mine is, how could I use my voice to mess with people? And
well,
I don't know where that's going.
I'll probably do some of that too. I mean, this was really good.
Scare my dad somehow.
Dude, this voice is so accurate. It's crazy.
I could scam my parents either out of money, I think would be interesting.
Oh, definitely.
And then just blame it on like, oh, somebody took my audio and made this AI thing. Mm-hmm. It wasn't me.
Yeah.
All right. This is, again, I'm not an ethics guy.
That
I'm
is,
not
an I was ethics just guy. Gonna say that's definitely coming from somebody who's not an ethics guy. Should I tell you? You want to see a little bit of like under the hood how you 100%, how I did yeah, this?
Absolutely.
Okay, so there's kind of two parts to this. There's the database that I'm collecting all this stuff in, yeah. And then there's the automation part of it. And so, just to get my voice done, I used 11 labs for the voice, and that's who I originally used way back last year. The tools just weren't good enough then.
Right.
And you can now create like a basic version of your voice, and all you need is like 30-second clip. Or if you're part of like their first level plan, you can create a professional level voice, and that allows you to upload a ton more audio and for
how
the
much
training.
Did you upload?
Because so that's where I was just going to say. So you can upload 1500 megabytes, I think it is, of audio files to it.
So what's that, 1.5 gigs?
It was somewhere like two. Yeah. So it was like almost like two-ish. And I took my single audio files from the last four of these that we did.
Yeah.
And then when I show you what the article outputs look like, I literally sat there and read, I don't know, maybe 2 hours worth of articles to this thing and recorded myself. So that way, so I got like the newsy type of style voice, right?
Yeah.
And that was the output of it, was this insane.
That's unbelievable.
This insane voice. All right. So I'll now show you kind of how it works underneath the hood really quick. We've got two things here. First, this Airtable database, right?
Yeah.
The Airtable database is kind of your content pool. I have it filtered here for just the articles and stuff, but you can actually, I could throw any piece of content in here that I have. So whether it's an article or just a show intro here, a piece of copy, a tweet, a YouTube transcript, any of that. And then I just tag it, right? And then I have links. And so the idea here is that you can take any piece of this content and repurpose it any way you want. So I've got essentially two major things working here to do this. So you've then got this automation. And so this is where I could probably create your little podcast thing right from this. Almost right. So what this one does is it takes an RSS feed that I have filtered for AI articles. It grabs them every morning at 8 o'clock. It downloads them, rips the text from them. And then I have basically a bunch of research assistants that I've put together with these massive prompts behind them. So it sends it to Perplexity to do more research from the internet. Then I have a virality assistant that I've trained this big prompt to kind of tell me, hey, how interesting and potentially viral is this article? Then I have one building me like a one-liner and hook for the article, one that does an overview, one that extracts all the specific insights and all the specific wisdom from that, right? And so what I get back after I run this is 20 articles every morning that come to me in this database like this, right? And so you can see here, I've got my one-liner. So what's the article about? Here's the overview. Here's the potential viral score of it. It's got my wisdom, my insights, and then like the additional data, the hooks, all that stuff, links to the article, right? So what it actually, so here you go. Let's see this one, score of 9. It's about millennial men leading in upskilling in AI. And this is all the stuff it gives back to me. All of this just from running that prompt. Very structured summaries, ideas, quotes, facts, references, recommendations, insights, all that kind of stuff. So I get this for every article. And then all I do is come here in this here, and I have a bunch of these kind of repurposing actions here. So media to transcription. So this is like if you have a YouTube video that you want transcribed. If I have that text article, I could turn it into a blog. I could turn the text into like visual carousels, tweets, and then all the way down to all the stuff I would need to make the podcast. So the like you can see article to script, then it creates the script for my intro, creates my script for my main body. And then I have the intro to a show description, which writes me all the show description. And then I actually have podcasts, which is the final audio file to publish directly to.
What audio, like what are they using to create the audio? Like, is it all through?
So I'll show you that here too, really quick. And so then that's the first, like that first tree of automation is how I get all this data in here. And then you're running, then I have this massive, massive automation with a ton of different. So all of this is what I do to get it all done. But there's a lot of like uploading to Google Drive and everything. But like I even have, so you could put a Slack voice note and go into that database to be created for something else later. But the main thing is this. So this is attached to that database. And depending on the action, it sends the router, it sends it to all of these different things. So this is going to give me a transcript of a video, send it back to my database. This one's going to, I don't know what this one's supposed to do off the top of my head, but it, they're all in coordination with that kind of list of transformations that I wanted to do. So at the end, you know, once I have my, these are all the ways that I get to my script. Script comes into this Google Doc. Once the script is in the Google Doc, I can, that's where I go in and I approve it. I look at the script. I say, this looks good. I actually have to make sure it has a character limit. And that's literally the only thing I do. Then I pass it to this, which records the whole script via the voice in 11 Labs and dumps it into my Google Drive. Then same with the show intro. And then this is my show description one that pulls, you know, back into there. So you're running all of these different automations, but it's all based just on that specific database. Isn't that wild?
It's unbelievable. Yeah, this is, it's impressive. How long did it take you to create kind of all these automations?
The first, the hardest part is, the hardest part is the prompting, because you need the actual automation building. Like once you know how to do it, it's really not that hard. You need to know how to build the database in a structured way to actually trigger all of this stuff. But once you know how to do it, you can make those trees in 10, 20 minutes, depending on if you know what the right thing to do is.
Yeah.
But what's really hard is get, and this is where I think most people struggle with AI in general, where they use it and they think, oh, this is a cool party trick, but it's not for me, is like, how do I get it to do those very specific things, right? And so working on those prompts to be able to get it to give me a viral one-liner hook that, you know, can be used for a video, that getting it to do that output is the is a lot of trial and error. But once you have it, then it's built and it's done. So like this took me, I mean, I've probably been working on this since, I started working on this since the last show. So
So a good week.
And I put out the first podcast yesterday, right? So it took me a week to build, and but took me a week to build for myself. If I wanted to go and reproduce it, I could reproduce it in a couple of hours. You know what I mean? So when we do this for our show here, that like just the content repurposing part, because I could take this now, we could give it the YouTube video, we could send it, we could send it to transcript. You can make tweets from that. You can make carousels from that. You can make whatever from that. And just by pushing those couple buttons. And then the part that I didn't put on this yet, but is coming, is like sending it out and scheduling it on social media, right? So like writing tweets from something and making sure that that's scheduled to have, you know, I approve it and it gets sent out for my five tweets a day or whatever.
What if we did this? Okay. What if we did this? What if we did the Wednesday show, which is our show? Okay.
Yeah.
We both agree that we like this setup.
Yeah.
The Wednesday show.
I enjoy the Wednesday show. Yes.
Live and in color.
Yes.
What if Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, we put out just a podcast using like doing all this. So like we don't have to do any of it and like have it. Like one. So one day a week is like a reality and 4 days a week is artificial intelligence.
I actually really like that. I like it even more if it's just total nonsense.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah.
Like simulating a conversation back and forth with us. I would love to be able to. I wish I could.
Because those ones could be like 15 minutes. Like those ones don't have to
be. Oh, yeah, totally. You know and it's mean? Like you could simulate something back and forth that is, I wish I had every transcript we ever did.
Could it learn from like, so say we do a bunch of these.
Yes.
And like 6 months from now, would it have learned past conversations and then kind of be able to like,
you could feed it. Yeah. You could have it take the new transcripts and keep going with it. Right. But even so, like what's even cooler is like, if you had all the old transcripts and it actually could learn from the way that we banter, right? Mm-hmm. And create a script. Like right now, if you went in and had like a TV show assistant and you trained it on every episode of Family Guy scripts, it could write you a good Family Guy script.
Yeah, like a pretty good Family Guy script.
It would be the same thing here. But I had two more things I wanted to show you, but we're running out of time. That one took a long time. Let me know what if you want to skip anything. Do you have crypto stuff?
I don't have crypto stuff. All I wanted to, I was thinking maybe we could do, I wanted your opinion on some social media outputs that we're doing.
We're in the right segment for it right now. I'll save these other two things for next show because they are fun. They're more of that fun, like blow your socks off demo shit that we've been looking at lately. So we could save that for another show.
So, yeah, I mean, when it comes to, getting content out for the show throughout the week, you know, I try and piece together parts of our conversation, but you know, I can only really put out one of those a day. Not, you know, as much as we think everything is gold, to clip it down into a 30-second clip, there's probably only, you know, 6 to 10 per week that we have. I like to sprinkle in some other things. So I'm trying to create more like AI songs based on what's happening in the world, or just shitty, like basic TikTok, you know, meme videos. So Payne, are you able to bring up oh, here we go. This is great. So if you scroll, you can see the kind of,
what's the most,
the most views is
13,500.
Yeah.
So no wonder.
So, you know, there's a smattering of different stuff. We did okay. And different. So these all go out on TikTok, on Instagram Reels.
Views? Oof.
Some work better than others. But if you go, Payne, if you scroll kind of back up to the top a little bit, and by the way, follow us on Instagram at MidMyCrisis, on TikTok at MidMyCrisis. And then we also put these out as YouTube shorts as well. Can you play Hot Cop, the detective? I think it's the 24. I don't have my glasses on. The one, it says Hollywood, Florida. Yeah, that one there.
So you made this with AI, the song?
Yeah, so this was a social media video that was, you know, making the rounds last week of this absolutely beautiful detective from Hollywood, Florida. I forget what the crime was, but the internet was going wild. So what I like to do is I take the audio out and then I put a song over the top And I thought like I went with 80s hair metal because I felt like that was like a, you know, a good depiction of.
Oh yeah, it's like Hot for Teacher. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. So Hot Cop was that one. I like that one a lot. It didn't. It wasn't the best one. If you scroll up a bit, Payne, you'll have. Go to the 13th or the 12,000 one, or whatever it is. The singer. So this was a gal at a festival.
Jean skirt, American flag, country show. But she doesn't know what she's singing with her beaver out.
And she does. So she doesn't know she's singing with her beaver out. Was a song. This was at some festival, music festival. I couldn't even find. I could not find her name. I could find the video. Nowhere. She's not. I'm assuming she's not.
I thought the song she was actually singing is pretty popular.
No, this is a song. The song she was actually singing.
So you could probably have found it by listening to the original. Is this Selena? It's not Selena Gomez, is it?
No. I feel like we would know if it was Selena Gomez walking around with her beeve out. But yeah, it was. She had this jean skirt. And every time she would turn a certain way, she was catching some waves.
Do you think that nobody saw this prior to like?
I think she was probably going commando and didn't realize the angles. Is my thought. She didn't realize.
We're gonna have to go to producer Payne for the final judge on this in 1 minute of Payne. Because I think he's got an opinion, so we'll get the tiebreaker. I feel like somebody must have known and didn't tell her.
Because it is a candle in the wind. I think I did one more song. If we got one more quick song.
So the songs are definitely my favorite.
The Trump one, I thought.
Oh,
this
I don't
was,
know if I saw that one.
This is the one I sent.
Yeah. I did see this one. How many views did this one get?
Depends. It got more views, and I think it got more views on YouTube Shorts. So it depends. Like one will do amazing on like one platform and not so good on another one. But this one, I think YouTube Shorts really like this one.
So I love these, but like they. I don't even know. I don't even know what this show is about. So like the problem is we're just putting out, you know, random cultural things, which I think is great. But that's why I feel like it's probably so hit and miss. You know what I mean? Like if we were super consistent about the stuff we were putting out, you'd probably start to hit an algo that gets you X views every time at least. You know what I mean? But I personally enjoy them very much. I asked you, I even texted you for your Enyo one the other day.
Yeah, you like the Enyo. What is that one again? Every time you say the Enyo one,
that's the singularity one that you have.
Oh, the singularity one is good. Yeah, you want to play that one? It's my face. The one, if you scroll down
one
a
more
little
row
bit,
down,
yeah, one
yeah,
more, and to,
go,
the, to the, right. The right, one more there. That,
that one.
One.
Shit. It's so good. I say keep doing them unless it takes you tons of
no
tons
I love
of time.
It I'm trying to figure out what's working, what's not working, but I feel like AI generated music is at least in
Well, the reason I like those and I think they work is that they allow you to be topically funny in a unique way. You know what I mean?
I agree.
Like putting that same viral video that everyone's watching with your twist on it, like your one-liner that's turned into a song, I think is really funny. You know?
And the cool thing too is a lot of the like Instagram and TikTok, a lot of where people get a lot of participation is when they take the audio and then make their own video. So like, you know, singing with their beaver out, like somebody could take that and it happens to somebody else. You know what I mean? Somebody else.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that it can get viral that way. So creating the audio, I think is the most key component there. But anyways, let's get to our final segment of the day with 1 minute of Payne.
He's not looking for any fame. It's too late to hide time for 1 minute of pain. 1 minute of pain.
Here we are with the final segment of the show, becoming my favorite segment, 1 minute of pain, where we talk to producer Payne about, you know, what we talked about on this show, plus whatever else is on his mind. Payne, how are you this afternoon?
You're on mute, buddy.
Payne's on mute. That is 1 minute of pain. 20 seconds of pain gone down the drain.
There
20 seconds of pain left.
And that was the pain. I'm doing great though. Thanks for having me as always, fellas.
Payne, rate the show today on a scale of 1 to 10.
You know, just because I'm tired of giving it tens, I'm going to give it a 9.5.
All right, fair. That's fair. I feel like fair. It could have been better.
I mean,
my audio at the start immediately.
That's really what dropped it. I didn't want to say it because I know how much it means to you. But
it means
and I know
so much to him.
It's so really going to bother you. That
you know what
first...
the worst part was?
It's also why I didn't say it. And then I thought to myself after you did that, like, of course I should have said it because otherwise he's going to scrap the whole fucking episode.
Oh, yeah.
I'll dust this thing. But you know what the worst part was? Is you said it and I'm like, oh, that's weird. I'm like, 100%. And I look over and my fucking mic is not plugged in. So upsetting. Just user error.
Oh boy. User error indeed. Payne, weigh in on singing with her beaver out.
Yeah. I don't actually know how to say her name. Maren Morris or something like that.
Were you aware of her? Like, is she fairly popular or did you?
I had no clue who she was until that. So no. I thought.
What'd you Google to find that?
I actually just used Chambers, whatever he put on. I think he put it on X as well, right?
Yeah, I did. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I used through that. I had to put in something. I think I just put
you put in hashtag singing with her beaver out.
Yeah.
That's where I was really trying to get.
I would show my search history, but I'm afraid of what might come up.
Hide those likes, Elon.
Keep them hidden. I thought maybe like, are they flesh colored panties or maybe it's
probably
the real thing?
Gotta be, right?
But
it's tough. I mean, we can't pull up the real one just in case it's not.
Right.
But yeah. It's close. I don't know. It could be flesh colored.
This is why we need AI. We could have been classifying.
I think we should get her on the show.
That's it.
Ask her directly.
Well, I know Payne was working on getting us the Hawk Tua girl. So,
yeah, she's just traveling all the time. You know, she's never
isn't
around.
Isn't she from your neck of the woods too?
She is. I could probably be in her neck of the woods in an hour. So,
yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah,
honestly though, she started talking, and I felt like I'm like, oh.
That's the
thing.
You going to
Bitcoin Nashville, Payne?
I'm going to make an appearance. I'm not paying for that ticket. I'll tell you that right now. But
it's
is that the one where Trump's going to be?
It is. It is.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. If I can get a media pass, I would love to.
Throw those DGEN network credentials out there and 100%. See what happens.
We are
a big deal, you know?
Well, you know, sometimes that works and they'll just like make me sign something. I still remember having to sign stuff for Mackie to go to VCon. I'm like, whatever, man.
Yeah.
Felt like I was signing his like, you know, field
who
trip
else is
notice.
Well, there were some other fairly big names, if memory serves me correct. Like terrible names, but big names.
The Bitcoin Nashville looks pretty legit in terms Michael Saylor is going to be there.
Michael Saylor was going to be there. Yeah, that was a good one.
You'll probably get him singing with his beaver out at some point.
One other thing I did want to do, since we didn't get dad talk, I guess I'll give like perspective dad talk.
Yeah, for sure.
Last on Sunday had a birthing class and, you know, at that point started to realize like, holy crap, this could come
real.
Like this is coming any second.
Listen,
and I'm not prepared.
I'm gonna be honest with you. Okay. Here's some tips for any dads out there or soon to be fathers. When you're in the room, okay, when it's go time.
Where is this going?
You make sure you stay above the belt line. Okay?
Oh no, I basically delivered both of my kids.
Some things you can't unsee is all I'm saying.
Yeah, it's like a horse blinking.
Yeah, but also too, there's projectiles coming sometimes. Like, it's, you stay above the belt line, you're gonna be just fine.
Dude, that's... both times I literally, like, I don't know, I should have invoiced them. I had to, like, basically deliver my first.
The fact that you guys COVID. Pay for these kids and you've done that, like, I walk out, you know, 48 hours later, I don't even think about the hospital anymore.
I'm still thinking about the hospital. Yeah,
I believe it.
All right.
Let's just have them in Canada. Come on over. I'll invite you. Just whenever you get, like, you know, 2 weeks away, come visit old Chatter. And
make sure you're prepared for the hospital, both you and your wife. It's a long time that you're there. You're going to need some kind of go bag. You're going to need snacks and, you know, things for both you and your wife. So make sure that you're thinking about that, because the go bag is key.
Yeah, we packed it yesterday. We're now ready for anything.
What kind of time frame are we looking at here? Like, any day or like a couple weeks?
36 and a half, so, you know.
Oh.
Yeah. Ooh, baby, it's coming.
Yeah.
I think both of mine were like 37 weeks, so.
Ooh, don't tell me that.
Both of mine were like right on time and a week late.
Ooh. A week late. Yeah, you don't
actually
want late.
No, wait. Both of mine were late.
Ooh, that's rough. Late. That's rough stuff. Yeah. All right.
It was. Anyway, go do some horse stuff. And you got horse stuff today?
Oh, horse stuff today, buddy. You know it.
Winnie.
Did I tell you she got first place at her last one?
The horse or your daughter?
Both. They competed together.
Okay, good. Combined. I didn't know. Combined. I don't know what it's like. I don't know if they like fight each other or what it is.
Yeah, first place.
Cool. Wow.
Yeah,
best in show.
Brought a tear to my eye.
That's amazing. You're the best horse coach trainer out there.
I really am.
That's it. That's going to do it for us today. Don't forget, like, subscribe, retweet, follow, all those things. Join the Firebrain AI community if you like the AI stuff and want to learn more. Subscribe to the new podcast. Maybe Chamber and I will have a daily back and forth in which AI just talks as us.
That'd be great.
I'm actually really interested.
I like this.
I need you to go train your voice ASAP. And we're gonna do this. So we'll figure it out. But anyway, that's gonna do it for us. Until next time, keep the mic hot.
What have I done? What have I become? I can't describe this.